Hello, I'm Michael Kukura. This is number 0793, the Stuff File Program with Peter Anthony Holder, and it comes to you right now.
The following program is brought to you in living color.
Now, it's time for an eclectic mix of interviews and some of the oddest news stories you'll ever hear. It's the Stuff File Program with Peter Anthony Holder.
Hey there, hi there, ho there! Peter Anthony Holder here with you, and yes, this is indeed another edition of the Stuff File program, number 0793. And coming up on this edition of the Stuff File program, you'll meet David McCloskey, who is the author of a CIA thriller entitled The Seventh Floor. As a former CIA analyst himself, does he have to clear whatever he writes with the agency?
You do. I was led into a very small room on my last day at Langley and given a large stack of papers, which, of course, I wasn't allowed to keep. But one of them said basically everything I write going forward would have to be cleared by what's known at the CIA as the Publication Review Board. So all of my books, any articles I write, all the way down to how I write about the CIA on my resume, goes through them for clearance, and they can, of course, you know, redact things as they see fit.
Burt Kearns is the author of Shemp, a biography of the Three Stooges' Shemp Howard, the face of film comedy. Shemp was the unsung, almost forgotten Stooge. Why is that?
Just about every book and every documentary that has been done about the Three Stooges goes back to the Bible, which is the autobiography of Mo Howard. Mo wrote a book toward the end of his life. He died before he finished it. His daughter finished it for him. That's been the resource. And what I found was that the book is fiction. Mo wrote a book that is very self-aggrandizing, very much puts himself at the center of creativity and the group from the very beginning, at the expense of his older brother, Shemp.
Science writer Andrew Fazekas, the night sky guy, talks about the breakthrough achievement of SpaceX when they recaptured a booster rocket right onto its own launch pad.
It's like an amazing kind of maneuver of being able to catch this booster, because this first stage booster, the idea is to reuse it over and over and over again. So not to ditch it into the ocean or burn it up into the atmosphere, but actually catch it, grasp it. And this was seemed like something out of science fiction. I was watching this mission unfold, and to see that first stage booster being picked off directly from on the launch mount, it's amazing.
And there's lots and lots of Stuff File news and, of course, an idiot of the day. The guest Slater, the person who told you this was show number 0793, was Michael Kukura, a former college classmate and also a former co-worker at a television station here in town. Thank you very much, Michael, for doing the guest Slate on this edition of the Stuff File program, a show that is listener-supported, fan-funded radio that depends on you for our success. Join us at patreon.com to help make this show an even bigger and better radio experience. Well, let's get right to the stuff. If you're running for office, a leaked videotape can do you in. David Cavender, who is opposing Cobb County, Georgia Sheriff Craig Owen Sr. in the coming election, shared body cam footage showing sheriff's deputies responding to an apparent call for backup from Owens. The video showed deputies using their sirens and running red lights to a local Burger King. "Hey, do me a favor," Owens said to a responding deputy. "All I need is the owner's name of whatever owns this damn facility or the manager." He said the restaurant got his order wrong and denied his request to replace it. Again, all of this is on the officer's body cam. Owens went on to say,
"I don't need no damn money back no more. I just need to find out who owns this place so I can do a physical complaint to complain."
Deputies discovered the restaurant was locked. Employees opened up for the deputies, explaining they locked up because many upset customers turned violent. Owens defended his actions, saying it was a simple business dispute, and he did what any citizen could do. He said, "I was not in my uniform. At no point did I indicate my position, nor did I ask the responders to do anything that they would not, had not, or have not done for anyone else who makes a business dispute call. However, I found this exchange on the body cam telling.
You didn't tell him who I was.
No, I just told him it was the guy out in the truck, so I wouldn't tell him who he was.
Yeah, nothing like a little abuse of power, huh? And by the way, if he wasn't intimidating when he went into the Burger King, then why, after he left, did they lock the doors? I'm guessing with Sheriff Owens, this is just another case of someone who took Burger King's slogan a little too literally.
Have it your way.
Come on now.
Have it your way.
Still with fast food, nope, that wasn't Parmesan cheese to sprinkle on your pizza. Police in Dusseldorf, Germany uncovered a drug ring after busting a pizzeria manager who was selling a popular number 40 pie, and I was doing air quotes for number 40, which was delivered with a side of cocaine. As officers buzzed the apartment of the manager, he threw a bag of cocaine, cannabis, and money out the window, which landed in the officer's hands. After the manager was released, he went right back to delivering number 40, and that's when investigators uncovered the supply chain, arresting three suspects and raiding the homes of 12 others. Pizza Man is now back in custody. Wow. He must really have had people jonesing for their number 40.
Oh, Pizza Man's here. Do I look okay?
And finally in this section of Stuff File News, before we get to our first guest here in this edition of the Stuff File program with me, Peter Anthony Holder, if you think you see gravel along East Queen Avenue in the Hilliard neighborhood of Spokane, Washington, you might be looking at the deposits of the 25 to 75 local rabbits, all descendants of a live Easter gift several years ago that was dumped outside after the holiday. Complained resident Hope Walker, "Our property is their current grocery store and no mitigation methods we have tried have made any difference." Well, maybe they're not, you know, ordinary rabbits.
Well, that's no ordinary rabbit. That's the most foul, cruel, and bad-tempered rodent you ever set eyes on.
Spokane code enforcement told Walker nothing prohibits feeding rabbits, and since no one owns them, no one can be cited for owning too many. The city and county have rules for cats, dogs, and inherently dangerous animals, but none for bunnies. Said Walker, the rabbits bring visitors to look at them, or in at least one case, chase them around her yard with nets. She told that father and his kids to leave. Now, try that on the bunnies. You know, I'm old enough to remember 1972. That year, a movie came out about killer rabbits.
What is the terrifying mutant that strikes from behind the shroud of night?
I'm sorry. Did you say mutant? You mean mutant, right? Anyway, go on.
That night. That night of the Lepus. A night of total terror. More shattering than your strangest nightmare. What caused the unnatural death, destruction, and panic that night of the Lepus?
Well, you could always round them up and kill them.
Kill one, and thousands take their place. What can stop them? Night of the Lepus.
Yeesh. Hope Walker and the town better heed their warnings. Anyway, let's get to our first guest here in this edition of the Stuff File program, shall we? David McCloskey is a former CIA analyst turned spy thriller novelist. His third novel has just been released. It's called The Seventh Floor. David joins us via Zoom from Washington, D.C. Hi, David.
Hey, great to be with you. Thanks for having me on.
Thanks for being on the program with us. I want to get into what The Seventh Floor is about, but before we do that, I just want to know, do you have to clear stuff as a former CIA analyst with the CIA when you write?
You do. I was led into a very small room on my last day at Langley and given a large stack of papers, which, of course, I wasn't allowed to keep. But one of them said basically everything I write going forward would have to be cleared by what's known at the CIA as the Publication Review Board. So all of my books, any articles I write, all the way down to how I write about the CIA on my resume, goes through them for clearance. And they can, of course, you know, redact things as they see fit.
Have there been things over the years that you've written that has been redacted? Obviously, you're not going to tell me what they are, but have there been anything?
There have been some things, yes. You know, I try to be careful with what I write and really attempt to not put anything overly sensitive or certainly classified into the books. But there have been a few cases of small things, mostly names of, you know, particular parts of the agency or little bits of tradecraft that they have decided to take out. But it's never been anything that changes the story, let's say, changes the plot. Small things, but there have been some things they've taken out.
Have you ever been surprised by some of the things they might have redacted?
I have been, actually. There have been a number of things that have felt as though they're sort of part of the public domain that have, I guess, not been formally, that the CIA has taken out, like names of particular pieces of the organization that you could find, you know, if you Googled them, but the CIA felt were a little bit sensitive. So those things were a little surprising to me. They are, I will say, though, in general, quite willing to work with me and flexible. And I also try to play by the rules. So I, you know, I source everything. I source my novels when I send them to them. So they know where I get the information that I have and that, you know, we can all be comfortable. It doesn't come out of the classified part of my brain.
Okay. I won't grill you anymore on the CIA. Let's talk about the book, The Seventh Floor. What's the story about?
So the Seventh Floor is a story about essentially a modern mole hunt. There is a traitor, a double agent working at Langley, working for Moscow. And they are working on the sort of famed Seventh Floor, which is the CIA's executive suite where the director works and sort of lives and breathes every day. The Russians have someone up there working for them. Who is it? And this is a story that features a really colorful, kind of deranged case officer named Artemis Proctor, who is a feature in my first two books and who's back for this one. She is run out of the service early in the novel and kind of comes back in an unofficial capacity to investigate who this mole might be. And as she does so, she comes up with a short list of suspects that are essentially her closest friends and some of her fiercest enemies. So it's a story, of course, about, you know, modern espionage, the modern CIA betrayal. But it's also a story about friendship and, frankly, what does friendship look like in what can be quite a faithless business?
You know, describing the plot that you, as you've just described it, going back to my previous question, I would find it difficult for the CIA to agree to any of this being in a book.
They cleared it. You know, what can I say? I'm not revealing sources. I'm not revealing specifics about some of our more sensitive methods. There are some things in here, I think, that I'm sure don't and won't reflect positively on CIA, but we have, you know, the First Amendment here in the States. We don't have an official Secrets Act like the Brits do that sort of permits the security services to embargo what's written, and they cleared it. So, you know, I'm grateful for that. Let's put it that way. So I get these stories out.
Well, going back to when you were in the CIA, did your worldview change due to your involvement with the CIA?
Yeah, I think so. You know, I joined really young. I was an undergraduate intern, actually. I took my first polygraph at 19 and joined when I was 20. So I kind of grew up in it. I think one thing it does give you is a perspective on how the world actually works, which I think in some respects is really enlightening and, you know, certainly very educational, right? I mean, you really see sort of the guts of how do governments interact with one another? What is the massive gap between what is actually said and what's done? that makes you a little cynical, I think. And that makes you, you know, a good analyst. It, I think, makes and has helped form me as a writer, because I have a better understanding of how these governments work, how they interact, how people inside them interact with one another. And it's given me a lot of really great fodder for these stories.
Taking a polygraph when you were 19 years old. Did your parents get the analysis of that?
You know, I'm sure they would love to see it, as would I. They were subjected to, you know, I had to go through a big background investigation, and they had a couple investigators come by the house and do interviews at our house, talk to neighbors, talk to friends. So they, you know, it was a little bit more invasive, let's say, than any of my high school job, you know, job interviews had been. We'd all like to see the psych examination, though. You know, that's not something I was privy to in the HR files. But, you know, I'd love to see the declassified version of what the agency psychiatrist thought about 19-year-old me as I was being interviewed and polygraphed.
Okay, so again, as a former CIA analyst, should the general public be more worried or more reassured by the geopolitics based on what you know?
I think everyone should be sort of appropriately concerned about the geopolitical situation today. I think we're living in a world where we have a confluence of revenge of geopolitics. You can look at the Middle East, you can look at Russia, you can look at China, you can look at North Korea, the relationships between them. It's a sort of an unprecedented situation in the post-Cold War era to have so many sort of surging or resurgent autocratic powers all around the world. I think you could look at the tech wave we're riding, and in particular, the fusion of sort of synthetic biology and artificial intelligence, and what that means for sort of the technologization of life and intelligence. And, you know, you sort of look at all this and you say, well, let's look at us domestically. And are we better able now to sort of help to manage and steer the international environment than we were 30 years ago? I don't think that's the case. So I'm not a doom and gloom kind of guy in general, but I think I'm appropriately cynical about it and think there are a lot of things to worry about. There's a lot of cause for optimism, too, in this country, but certainly on the international scene, I think a lot of things that are worrisome.
Okay, so again, since you're a former CIA analyst who now writes spy thriller novelists, I'll ask that last question from a different perspective. Should the general public be more worried or more reassured by geopolitics after reading your novels?
Well, I think they should be more inclined to keep reading my novels, certainly. I think that the books are trying to deal really realistically with this environment. And so, and by that, I mean the geopolitical environment. So I think I'm hopeful that readers will come to these books and say, I'm being entertained, certainly. I can't stop turning the pages, but I'm also getting a sense through fiction of how the world actually works and what's going on today. You know, the most recent book, The Seventh Floor, is giving you a sense, I hope, of kind of the modern day CIA, the modern day competition between the CIA and its Russian counterparts, the SVR. And the book I'm working on now, you know, the fourth one, is in the middle of the competition or sort of shadow war between Israel and Iran. And so I'm hopeful that as, you know, readers engage with this stuff, they're getting a sense of how this actually functions. And importantly, getting a sense of the fact that in the middle of all of these conflicts are actual people who look at them, think about them very differently. And I want to bring readers into that world.
We should mention that your previous two books are Moscow X and also Damascus Station, and now The Seventh Floor. You now have a series. You're writing the fourth. Would you like to see these turned into anything cinematic, either on the big screen or small screen?
Oh, absolutely. I would love that. We've actually had some success, at least in getting that process going. The film and TV rights have been sold to Damascus Station, the first book, and to Moscow X, the second one. So, you know, hopefully that will happen in the not so distant future. I think that these stories would be wonderful on the small screen and the big screen. And I'm, you know, crossing my fingers, knocking on wood, that that it does happen.
Does this give any insight, again, since the CIA is redacting stuff, obviously, does this give any insight when reading your books to the enemy?
Oh, I really hope they do. I mean, you know, in each of the books, I've really attempted to render the opposition, as it were, as credibly and as authentically as possible. So in the first book, Damascus Station, there are Syrian intelligence officers, Syrian government officials, you know, you're in their heads. In the second book, and now the third one, The Seventh Floor, you're in the heads of Russians who are really attempting to penetrate the CIA, to run agents against us, to sort of engineer the way we all think about what's going on in the world. And, you know, I am not trying to create a sense of moral equivalency between us and the opposition, but I am trying to show what those people are like, what they think, and to really bring you into their heads and their worlds. It's really an important piece of this for me to kind of get the personal and character dynamics right for people that we don't normally spend a lot of time, you know, sort of thinking their thoughts and walking in their shoes.
Well, congratulations on your ongoing series. The latest book is The Seventh Floor, which is now out. David, thank you very, very much for being on the program with us.
Thanks for having me. Really enjoyed our chat.
David McCloskey, author of the spy thriller novel, The Seventh Floor. You can go to our website at thestuffile.com, check out the show number for this program, which is show number 0793, and you'll find the link to David's site, plus links to either amazon.com or amazon.ca, where you can order his book directly. You're listening to The Stuff File program with me, Peter Anthony Holder.
There's still more guests, more news, and an idiot of the day coming your way on The Stuff File program. Stay tuned. The Stuff File program is a listener-supported, fan-funded radio show that depends on you for our success. Join us at patreon.com to help make this show an even bigger and better radio experience. Sign up and find out about our rewards program. Being a patron doesn't have to be a long-term commitment. There's absolutely no obligation. You could join today and end whenever you'd like, but the time we have your support would be so greatly appreciated. We'd also love to hear your thoughts about the show and even your ideas for rewards. Join us for the ride. Join us at patreon.com/thestufffileprogram. You're listening to The Stuff File program with Peter Anthony Holder. Viewer discretion is advised. But then again, why are you staring at a radio program?
And still to come on the program, we'll talk to Burt Kearns, who is the author of Shemp, a biography of the Three Stooges, Shemp Howard, the face of film comedy, and basically, the forgotten stooge. Also, Andrew Fazekas, the night sky guy, is back on the show to talk about SpaceX boosters landing and other things as well. We also have an idiot of the day coming your way a little later on, and also much more in Stuff File News right here, right now. Halloween is the time to get creepy, and this story might be the one to just creep you out. The waiting list is long for a chance to visit McCammy Manor in Summertown, Tennessee, an immersive horror experience that is personalized to each guest and involves a six-hour-long tour. At one point, the haunted house had a 27,000-person wait list and offered a $20,000 reward if you completed the entire tour. Guests are required to sign a 40-page waiver and must be over 21. In addition, they may have to complete a sports physical and provide proof of medical insurance before arriving. Said owner and Navy veteran Russ McCammy, "We're known for no quitting and no safe word. Your hair might be chopped off, dentistry may be done, you may have a tooth extracted." McCammy was arrested in July for second-degree attempted murder, rape, and domestic violence after an incident with his girlfriend, but the charges were dropped in September, and McCammy Manor is still up and running. I honestly don't know who are the sicker people here, the people who run this place, or the over 27,000 who are on the waiting list. Ooh. Travelers leaving the New Zealand city of Dunedin better say their goodbyes at home. The airport's drop-off area will now restrict parting hugs to 3 minutes in an effort to prevent traffic jams. Airport CEO Dan DeBono, who probably wasn't hugged as a child, said officials hope to, quote, keep things moving smoothly, unquote. Not all travelers are accepting of the time limit, saying the rule breached basic human rights. But DeBono assured them, we do not have hug police. Well, not yet. Okay, I have to admit that I am a hugger. I will hug any and everyone. Still, I don't think I've ever reached the upper time limit of a 3-minute hug. I mean, that seems to be a little codependent and needy. Scientists say they found 7 new frog species whose whistling is reminiscent of tricorders and boatswain's calls from the Star Trek TV shows. On announcing the discovery, Miguel Vences, one of the authors of the paper, which is included in the pages of Vertebrate Zoology, and yes, I read them all, folks, he said, this is why we name the frogs after Kirk, Picard, Sisko, Janeway, Archer, Burnham, and Pike, 7 of the most iconic captains from the sci-fi series. Finding the frogs was not an easy, dare I say, enterprise. Said Vences, we had to undertake major expeditions to remote forest fragments and mountain peaks. One of his co-authors said the frogs' high-pitched calls enabled them to be heard over the sounds of the Madagascar rainforests. Well, until they find frogs to name after Captain Shaw and Captain Sulu, the frogs announced so far will be 7 of 9.
To boldly go where no man has gone before.
And we have one more story to share with you in this section of Stuff File News before we get to our next guest here on the Stuff File program with me, Peter Anthony Holder. And the bells signify that it's time once again for The Darwin File.
I am the Grim Reaper. I am death.
The Castilla-La Mancha Bridge in Talavera de la Reina, Spain, is one of the tallest in Europe at 192 meters or 630 feet tall and attracts people climbing to the top of the picturesque span for a view despite that being totally prohibited. According to authorities, 26-year-old Lewis Stevenson from England, who was traveling with another Brit, climbed it to create content for social networks. Stevenson came to their attention since, before he could get to the top, he fell to his death. His mother, Kelia Stevenson, admits her boy was a thrill seeker, but insists he was not a social media influencer. Rather, she said, he knew his limits and never did anything beyond them. Really? Really. Clearly, ignoring reality runs in this family. And it's one of the many reasons that the Tree of Life is often self-pruning.
I have come for you. I am death.
Anyway, let's get to our next guest here in this edition of the Stuff File program. Burt Kearns is an author, journalist, and film and television producer. He is also the author of a biography about one of the Three Stooges, and it's probably not about the Stooge that you're thinking of. The book is called Shemp, a biography of the Three Stooges, Shemp Howard, the face of film comedy. And yes, it's about Shemp Howard, the older brother of Moe. He left the Stooges in 1932, going on to an amazing solo career. Burt joins us via Zoom from Los Angeles. Hi, Burt.
Hi, how are you doing?
Just tickety-boo. Thanks very much for being on the program with us. So what led you to bringing out the world of Shemp, who is probably an amazing career that he had, but an unsung hero?
That's it. You know, when I first started this project, there had not been a book about Shemp Howard. There's books about Moe, Curly, Larry Fine, even Joe Besser and Joe Derrida, who followed Shemp, but there'd never been a book about Shemp. So I got started on that. Interestingly, this began as a simple biography project. And probably it's the first book about one of the Stooges that's not written by a member of the fan base, that Stooges community. You know, I took this on as a biography project. And once I started digging, I found out that this history of the Three Stooges is just full of mythology and misinformation, and dug some more and found out the reason is that just about every book and every documentary that has been done about the Three Stooges goes back to the Bible, which is the autobiography of Mo Howard. Mo wrote a book toward the end of his life. He died before he finished it. His daughter finished it for him. It's called Mo Howard, I Stooged to Conquer. You could still buy it online. It's been out there. That's been the resource. And what I found was that the book is fiction. Mo wrote a book that is very self-aggrandizing, very much puts himself at the center of creativity and the group from the very beginning at the expense of his older brother, Shemp.
When I came across this book, one of the things that caught my attention is the fact that, you know, I grew up watching a lot of old movies on television, like many of the people who grew up in the 60s and 70s did. And you realize that Shemp Howard is probably in everything.
That's one of the things. You know, when Shemp left the Stooges originally in 1932, he left for a solo career, first in shorts and then as a character actor in films. And he shows up, as you said, everywhere in films with W.C. Fields, James Stewart, John Wayne. He's in 5 Abbott and Costello pictures, pictures with the East Side Kids who became the Bowery Boys. He was in the Blondie movies. He was in the Thin Man series and Charlie Chan. He just happened to have this bag of tricks, these different characters he could play that fit into every picture, whether it was for, you know, one scene, a little comic relief, or a role that lasted throughout the picture. He was very talented and very versatile, much more versatile than his brother Mo, his younger brother Curly, or Larry Fine. He was the only one in the group that could really stand out on his own.
And he also didn't just act in comedies.
No, that's the thing. He was a well-rounded actor. You know, one of the films that you can find online, which is one of my favorites, it's always back from 1935. It's called Convention Girl. And I don't know how it got past the Hays Code censors. It's about a woman running prostitutes in Atlantic City. Shemp plays a thug. He plays a mobster. That was one thing he did. He played a lot of comic mobsters throughout his career. He was in a bunch of Damon Runyon pictures, but this one's a drama. And Shemp is funny. He can't help but be a bit humorous, but he plays a guy who pulls off a blackmail plot. And when his partner demands his share of the money, Shemp shoots him and kills him. And you're looking at it and you're like, this is like Joe Pesci in Goodfellas. And it really makes you wish that Shemp did more dramatic roles, which he may have done if he hadn't rejoined the Stooges in 1946.
Well, that's what I wanted to ask about, too, because he left the Stooges in 1932. And later on, as you said, Mo wrote a book which basically gave him all the credit. So I'm just wondering, what was the relationship between the two of them?
This is the thing. They were a family. They were families of Lithuanian immigrants in Brooklyn in the early part of the century, the late part of the 19th century even. Shemp was born in 1895. And they were family. And throughout this, they still were family. Mo had his position in the family, which was he was sort of able to guilt Shemp back into it. You know, Shemp happened to be working at Columbia Pictures as a solo star of shorts and also an actor in various films when Curly began to fade, when Curly had his debilitating stroke. And Mo really guilted him into taking over to kind of save the family business. Shemp rejoined and put it in writing. This is going to be temporary until Curly gets better. Well, Curly didn't get better. And Shemp wound up remaining with the Stooges through the end of his life and beyond the end of his life. Because when Shemp died at the age of 60 in 1955, the Stooges still owed 4 more shorts to Columbia Pictures. And the boss, Harry Cohn, said, I still want those 4 shorts. So they made 4 more shorts after Shemp died, starring Shemp and using an actor. They'd show the back of his head or show the back of his body portraying Shemp in it, known as the fake Shemp.
Wow, it's almost like the Bela Lugosi story, too, as well.
Exactly, yeah. As a matter of fact, today, in the industry, whenever they use another actor to fill in for a star, they call that actor the fake Shemp.
Why did he leave the Stooges in the first place back in 1932?
Well, if you listen to Mo, and if you read a lot of the books, you know, because Mo actually also, you know, he survived Shemp by 20 years and wound up doing a lot of television and radio interviews that you can still find online, and people still use as the resource. It was because Shemp was afraid. At the time, the Stooges were working as, quote, Stooges for a performer named Ted Healy. He was a song and dance man, a comedian, all-around entertainer on Broadway and in vaudeville. And what their act was, he would be singing a song, and one of the Stooges would come out and interrupt the song. They do a comedy bit, and Healy would finish the bit by slapping the Stooge in the face loud enough so that slap could be heard in the back row of the last balcony. And so, according to Mo, Shemp was afraid of Healy, afraid of getting hit. Healy had an alcohol problem. But when you dig into the facts, when you go into the trades at the time and reportage and talk to people who know, Shemp quit because he wanted more money. He was the star of the act. He was the one who was sort of, Ted Healy was his straight man. And Shemp said, you know, I want more money. And Ted Healy said, no, I paid the three of you guys a certain amount. If you want more money, go change the split with Larry and Mo. And they wouldn't do it. So Shemp went off into the great unknown. You know, Shemp, who's supposedly phobic and afraid of his own shadow, ventured off, you know, as a solo performer and thrived.
Are there any descendants left of Shemp? Of Shemp, rather?
There are descendants. I thought you said defendants. But no, yes. Descendants. There are descendants. Yeah, he has a daughter-in-law. His son, he had one son named Mort, who died early in the 1970s. His daughter-in-law, Geraldine, is still alive. He has two granddaughters, one of whom was an infant while he was still alive, but the other one had never met him. But they have a Facebook page called the Shemp Howard Goyles Group, and it's his daughter-in-law, two granddaughters, and great-granddaughter, where they share information about Shemp, memories they have from the family, and a lot of photos and videos.
The reason why I ask the question is the fact that you're writing this book, which tells the story of Shemp and brings him into the spotlight, and I'm assuming that this is a thankful tome for the family, especially since they were under the thumb quite a bit from Mo, who outlived him for 20 years and rewrote his own story.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Mo survived. He wrote the history. Everybody copies it. And the family members do say, no, wait a minute. You know, Mo claims he was the first Stooge. But no, they say, no, actually, no. Shemp was the first Stooge. Shemp was the first one there. You know, Mo tells a story of joining with his childhood friend Ted Healy in about 1923. Then Shemp came on board. And Mo says there was an unbroken, you know, string of performances up until, you know, the 1960s when the Stooges finally ended their run. But he leaves out the fact that in those early years, Mo quit the team for 3 years to sell real estate with his mother. And Shemp, on his own, went out with Ted Healy from about 1925 to 1929. He went out there and he conquered Broadway, got great reviews in the New York Times, got his name in lights in the same size as Ted Healy's, conquered vaudeville, went out on the road, you know, and the thing with Shemp is that, you know, to his, not discredit, but it was a very thankless role he took when he took over for Curly, because who could replace Curly, especially a man who looked like Shemp, once voted the ugliest man in Hollywood.
Well, I assume that wherever Shemp is right now, he is smiling with gratitude for this particular book, because it finally tells the true story of who he was and his place in Hollywood history.
Most definitely. And again, it's all out there. People can go on YouTube, there's Blu-ray, and find a lot of unexplored Shemp outside of the Three Stooges, as well as some of the work he did in the Stooges as well, which is great.
Well, thank you very much, Burt, for being on the program with us. It's a pleasure to have you on to talk about Shemp Howard. Basically, I would like to call the forgotten Stooge.
No longer. Thank you.
Burt Kearns, author of Shemp, a biography of the Three Stooges, Shemp Howard, the face of film comedy. You can go to our website at thestuffile.com, check out the show number for this program, which is show number 0793, and you'll find the link to Burt's site, plus links to either Amazon.com or Amazon.ca, where you can order his book directly. You're listening to the Stuff File program with me, Peter Anthony Holder.
Got something for the mailbag? Drop Peter a line. He'd love to hear from you. Send your email to mailbag@thestufffile.com. And remember, Stuff is spelled S-T-U-P-H. That's mailbag@thestufffile.com. Or catch up with him on Twitter or Facebook. There's more Stuff File coming your way in just a few moments.
Here's a brief word about our show and my book. If you become a regular Patreon patron of the Stuff File program, I'll give you an e-version of my book, Great Conversations, My Interviews with Two Men on the Moon and a Galaxy of Stars. It's easy to do. Just go to patreon.com and become a patron to help make this show an even bigger and better radio experience. So, join Patreon and claim your copy of Great Conversations, My Interviews with Two Men on the Moon and a Galaxy of Stars. Sign up at patreon.com/thestufffileprogram.
Latitude, 47 degrees, 14 minutes north. Longitude, 84 degrees, 39 minutes west. Location, Montreal, Canada. This is the Stuff File program with Peter Anthony Holder. Now, the Stuff File presents Andrew Fazekas, the night sky guy. It's radio that's out of this world.
Andrew Fazekas, the night sky guy, is a member of the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada and author of National Geographic's Backyard Guide to the Night Sky and also National Geographic's Stargazer's Atlas, the ultimate guide to the night sky. And Andrew, the space fan world is still buzzing about the recent SpaceX landing of a booster rocket back at its launch pad.
Yeah, so this is a big step forward for SpaceX and Elon Musk's basically dream to make humans a multiplanetary species. He said that. He's said that for so long. That's his big dream, really, is to have our species be able to live on different planets. And to get that done, you need to have the technology, the workhorse rocket, to make that happen. And that is really SpaceX's Starship, where that's the spaceship that sits on top of the booster rocket, this mega-sized booster called Falcon Heavy. And so the two together are stacked on top of each other, and this booster rocket and the Starship together stacked have been undergoing initial tests, flight tests. And this last one that happened, we're talking about something that's 400 feet tall. It's enormous. It's the biggest rocket, eh, Peter? This is the largest rocket, even beating the size of the Saturn V. Wow. From the Apollo era that took us to the moon. So this is really humanity's biggest effort. And it was an amazing last flight in that what caught most people's attention was the booster rocket, Falcon Heavy, being able to come back to the launch pad and being basically picked up, basically clipped by what they are calling these giant chopsticks, basically chopsticks arms that were on the launch tower. And it's like an amazing kind of maneuver of being able to catch this booster, because this first stage booster, the idea is to reuse it over and over and over again. So not to ditch it into the ocean or burn it up into the atmosphere, but actually catch it. Grasp it. And this seemed like something out of science fiction. I was watching this mission unfold, and to see that first stage booster, being picked off directly from on the launch mount, it's amazing.
It absolutely is amazing, to the point where, I don't know about you, I've watched it several times now.
Yeah, because you go, well, how exactly? Let me see that again. And, it's funny, as we're doing this interview, I'm watching it too. I'm watching the video again because it's just so cool. It happened 7 minutes after it launched the Starship spacecraft into space. It went into space and it actually plopped down in back in the ocean. The spacecraft did, but the booster is, I think, really where everyone was watching, because this is, you have to remember, Peter, this is a major contract that SpaceX has with NASA, right?
Right.
It's a multi-billion dollar contract where they are now, originally you and I have talked so much about them use SpaceX's Dragon spacecraft that takes a human crew to the International Space Station, launching those Dragon spacecrafts to and from the space station. You know, we know that SpaceX has beaten hands down Boeing Starliner, right? And they're in business there.
Hold on. You say they've beaten hands down. That's like saying Usain Bolt took off at the beginning of a race and the other guy is not even out of the starter blocks. That's what that is.
Yeah.
That's not even a fair fight. Yeah.
No, you know, and you have to remember, this is not necessary. It's, you know, it sounds great. I mean, it's a glowing thing for SpaceX, a black eye for Boeing, but you have to remember from NASA's perspective, they might not be that happy because they wanted two companies. They gave out two contracts to two rival companies, and they wanted both of them to be functioning now as being a taxi service to the International Space Station. Well, and SpaceX has been servicing for 4 years now, multiple missions to and back, reusing the Falcon booster rocket. This is the smaller version, the baby version of what we were just talking about with the Falcon Heavy on the Starship. And they've been doing great there. But also, SpaceX has this other contract with NASA, again, multi-billion dollar contract, of building out the Starship system, the launch system that we just saw being tested for the Artemis program that will take humans back to the moon. And in fact, the Artemis three mission that's slated maybe, we're talking about 2027, 2028, when the second mission to the moon, but this and this time actually landing on the moon, the first actually attempt to land, that mission is going to rely on the Starship, a modified version of what we were seeing with this launch system, where the crew will be on there, a crew of three will be on that mission and on Starship. And so NASA's really watching, you know, how they're testing, how SpaceX is testing this Starship and the heavy Falcon booster, and to see it being, you know, captured for reusability was one of these major milestones that I think NASA was watching from SpaceX. So, you know, if they can repeat that now that there's the proof of concept, right? There's that they said, you know, on paper, they can do this. They can capture it with their chopstick mechanical arms on the launch pad. They did it. So can they repeat it? If they can repeat that in the follow-up test missions, I think we're in a different world of where SpaceX can go now.
Well, if you think NASA is upset because they don't have the two companies vying for each other, or with each other rather, to go into space, how do you think Boeing feels right now?
Yeah, I mean, you know, how does this bode for their ability to apply for other contracts to it. And they're also involved with the Artemis program as well. And how is that going to affect, you know, all of the things that they do for NASA? I mean, they have a very rich legacy, Boeing does. But boy, they're having a lot of problems now, even, you know, with their workers, strikes and all kinds of things. So I don't know. Their hands are full there at that company.
Well, we talked about this the last time we were on, and the fact that some people are saying, well, why don't we just write off Boeing? And you can't just do that because they're so intertwined with NASA to the point where they're actually co-venture partners when it comes to the ISS. But the ISS is not going to last forever. As a matter of fact, it won't make it into the next decade. So if that's the case, would that be a time when NASA could wash their hands of Boeing?
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, I think what you're pointing at is let them run out their existing contract with what the existing projects they have, and then just not renew them for future projects. But we'll have to see. Like I said, they're already involved with the Artemis program as well. Technologies from Boeing are incorporated into the rockets and everything. So the question is, you know, can they, will they, because of their rich legacy? We'll have to see. I mean, that's still a ways off, because the space station is still going to be around for another, you know, what, maybe 5, 6, 8 years. And then we don't really know. It's not very clear exactly if NASA, you know, and because things change, right? Like I'm thinking here, Peter, politics, right? Every time there's a new change up in the government, the U.S. government, and the White House changes from, you know, Democrat to Republican, whatever, things always change. And so the story may still not be written, the end story for the space station. I'm thinking perhaps they may sell it off to private companies. There's been a lot of talk about that. Where will that go? We'll just have to see.
We will definitely have to see. And you know what has happened once again? We have had so many issues that we wanted to bring up on this show. We wanted to talk about the Chandra Observatory, which has been in space for 25 years. And as a matter of fact, that's something that we wanted to talk about probably 2-3 shows ago, and we just never got to it. Plus the idea that our neighborhood might be getting bigger than we thought as far as the universe is concerned. And of course, we chatted forever on this particular issue, so we're not going to get to any of those on this edition of the Stuff File program, but we could do it as a Patreon reward extra. Are you game for that?
Oh, yeah. Let's do it. There's just so much juicy stuff we can get into.
Okay, so we'll see you on Patreon.
You bet. Clear skies.
Andrew Fazekas, the night sky guy. You can go to our website at thestumpfile.com to the page for this show, which is show number 0793. And you'll find links to Andrew's site to get your own personal autographed copy of his books. Patreon subscribers, you can hear more of Andrew as a Patreon reward extra, where we'll discuss the Chandra Observatory, our growing neighborhood in the universe, the viability of life on the moon of Uranus, and more. Just go to our Patreon page, and if you're not already a member, become one of the select patrons of the show. Visit patreon.com/thestufffileprogram. You're listening to The Stuff File Program with me, Peter Anthony Holder. And we do indeed have an idiot of the day coming your way, but I've got a few more Stuff File news stories to get to right here, right now. Ontario Provincial Police charged a Vermont man who allegedly illegally crossed the border into Canada and thought he was still in the United States. Renfrew OPP responded to reports of a truck being stuck at a drive-thru in Cobden, Ontario, at around 5 a.m. on October the 17th. After attending the scene and locating the driver, police say the driver didn't know where he was and told officers he thought he was still in the U.S. Police learned the driver had allegedly failed to stop at the border and there were grounds for his arrest. The man was also found to be impaired. OPP charged the 52-year-old from Milton, Vermont, with operation while impaired with alcohol or drugs. Meanwhile, the Canada Border Services Agency, or CBSA, confirmed a vehicle failed to stop at the Prescott Port of Entry on October the 16th at approximately 11:30 a.m. CBSA says it charged the Vermonter with willfully evading compliance with the Customs Act and contravening the Immigration and Refugee Protection Act by failing to appear for an examination. The man was released and is scheduled to appear in court on December 17th. Well, I'm assuming that being released means that he is able to go back to Vermont until his court date. What are the odds that he'll make it back on December 17th. Also, he blew by the border at 11:30 a.m. on the 16th and got stuck at a drive-thru approximately 18 hours later. Was he drunk all that time? And how drunk do you have to be to not notice that everybody around you was suddenly saying sorry and a lot? Okay, here's a question for you. It's mid-October in New York, and you have a beehive on your porch. Do you A, buy some bee spray, B, continue to ignore it because the cold will take care of it soon anyway, or C, light the porch on fire. Well, this is the Stuff File program, so it's a rhetorical question. A person trying to exterminate bees by taking a flame to the bee's nest in a porch roof nearly burned down a Beacon, New York home. The Beacon Fire Department responded to the structure fire just after 7 p.m. A second alarm was sounded at 7:10 p.m., and the fire was extinguished at approximately 7:30 p.m. There were no injuries, except maybe to the homeowner's psyche and his wallet. And boys and girls, it's that moment you've all been waiting for. It's time now for the Idiot of the Day.
And now it's time for the Strange Things Adults Do. This Stuff File presents the Idiot of the Day.
Martin County, Florida Sheriff William Snyder says it was an Uber driver who saved a homeowner from what could have been a real tragedy. A rider allegedly told the Uber driver that he was going to burn down a house, and the driver discreetly called 911. Deputies responded to find 33-year-old Carlos Agustin Flores with a laundry detergent bottle of gasoline, which he was spreading around outside a friend's house, and spotted Flores before he could light it, which you could hear from the police body cam video.
I can smell it. He's got a lighter in his hand. Yep.
Flores allegedly explained his motive. He loaned the friend $100 at a strip club for entertainment purposes, and he hadn't paid it back, said Sheriff Snyder when asked by a reporter what was Flores thinking, carrying a full container of gasoline, a match, and a large knife to collect a $100 debt. Snyder responded, I wouldn't even begin to take his thinking apart. Well, luckily, that's what we do here at the end of each show for the Idiot of the Day, so I will ask the reporter's question and also one of my own. Why, oh why, would Flores carry a full container of gasoline, a match, and a large knife to collect a $100 debt? And my deeper question is, why hatch this nefarious plan and tell your Uber driver, a total stranger, what exactly you plan to do at the end of your trip? One reason, and one reason only, you're an idiot!
Gee, I'm only a kid, but even I know you're an idiot.
And that's it for this edition of the Stuff File program, number 0793. Hope you enjoyed it. The website is thestufffile.com, and once again, Stuff is spelled S-T-U-P-H, where you'll find information and links on all of our guests by going to the weekly Stuff File page. Just look for the corresponding program number, and once again, that's 0793. Email me at peter@thestufffile.com. You can also find me on Facebook, Spoutable, Mastodon, and Blue Sky as PA Holder. Check us out on patreon.com, where you can become a patron of the program. Hope to see you back here for our next show on the air, online, or as a download. We're coming to you from everywhere, including kdxradio.com, over the air on World FM in New Zealand, WLSL-LP-FM in Dade City, Florida, KZZH-LP-FM in Eureka, California, CKUW-FM in Winnipeg, CFMU in Hamilton, CKLU in Sudbury, Local 107.3 FM in St. John, CHSR in Fredericton, CFQR 600 in Montreal, and also streaming on just about any streaming service your little heart desires. That's it. Bye-bye.
You've been listening to the Stuff File program with Peter Anthony Holder, a presentation of Flying Fish Communications. Always remember this very timely piece of advice. Good news is just life's way of keeping you off balance.